being in at the front desk, like, you know, the mask was under her chin.
My name is Susan Miller, and I will be your lay leader today. And I offer a special welcome to you if you are newly with us this morning. We are honored by your curiosity and presence. We invite you to stay with us for a discussion afterwards. Here at the fellowship, we have Roy Haynes, Cap Barnett, Jan Manning, Luke Crippin, and Charlie Jacobs, and about 10 laptops and tablets. And participating remotely, Richard Clark, Colleen Beery, and Pamela Cousinell. Our announcements were up on a slideshow before we started. If you miss something in the announcements, you can contact us through the website for the Lake Chapala Unitarian Universalist Fellowship. And so I just want to welcome you with live from Fellowship Hall, it's our LCUUF Sunday service. Our chalice lighting words are by Sarah Asher. May the light from this flame be a beacon of our faith in the days that grow dark and dreary. May the light from this flame be warmth to our spirits during nights of restless searching. May the light from this flame be a celebration of the truth meaning and joy we find here and in our dreams. Please light your chalice. We light our chalice with these words, which we sing together. Our opening words are by Chip Rausch. We are about to enter sacred time. We are about to make this time and this place sacred by our presence and intention. I invite us to turn down the volume on our fears, to remove our masks, and to loosen the armor around our hearts. Don't take my word for it. Do it as slowly as you need to. If you take a little risk with these good people, you may find that they have the same human needs as you do. Breathe. Let go of the expectations placed on you by others and those they taught you to place on yourself. Drop the guilt and the shame. Not to shirk accountability, but an honest expectation of the possibility of forgiveness. Let go of the thing you said the other day. Let go of the thing you dread next week. Be here, in this moment. Breathe here. Each week, we take time to remind ourselves that we belong to a community which cares for each other. We do this by sharing any significant joys or sorrows in our lives. If you have a joy or sorrow to share today, you can also type it into the chat and we'll try to read those aloud. Let us begin by recalling our concerns and sorrows. Whatever you or the world may be holding that is in need of our healing and caring thoughts. You are welcome to type other sorrows and concerns in the chat box. I'd like to read a concern from Lynn Cleek. Please light a candle of concern for Liz Mulder, who went into the Ahahi Hospital Saturday morning with a fierce infection. She will be there at least 24 hours, and I'm sure she would love to read an email or two if anyone is so inclined. And from Roy Haynes. Please light a candle of remembrance in honor of David Hudnall's mother, Paulina Hudnall, who passed away on Friday from coronavirus. Thank you for all your thoughts and support during this time of loss in our family. Grammy was a wonderful wife, mother, a grandmother, mother-in-law, sister, aunt, friend, and an overall good person who will be missed by many.
And from Pamela, from our friend, David with advanced Lyme, who just broke his hip and neck.
Now let us recall the joys, whatever you may be celebrating, whatever it's a feeling of joy or peace for yourself or others. You are welcome to type other joys in the chat box. We have a joy from Helen White. Bill and I celebrated our 66th wedding anniversary on August 8th. We send our love to all.
And Kathy, safe at home and reunited with Carrie. So happy to be here. And for Matt, we had the excitement of the earthquake this morning. All is well, but wow.
Now our care candle will be lighted. For our world is one world. Our three speakers, Trudy Crippin, Sandy Boyd, and Robert Barnett. One of our speakers today, Sandy Boyd, is not a member of our congregation. Sandy was recommended by a friend of one of our members. She has worked in Houston, Texas at the Center for the Healing of Racism and helped to produce a conference about the healing of racism last year in Houston.
Good morning. Good morning, everyone. I was asked to speak today because I've spent a number of years, almost 25 now, as a minority. I was originally a minority in Asia, particularly North Asia. And I was based in Hong Kong, and I had spent 10 months in Hong Kong and Tokyo and Beijing and Seoul and so on, and I didn't really think much about it. Then I went down to Australia, which was also part of my region, and I went to Melbourne, and I was on the cam, and I had thoughts. I looked around, and my first thought was, no one's staring at me. And my second thought was, everyone's really ugly. And if life were judged on beauty without racial baggage, I think that Europe would come out on the bottom. But it was an eye-opener for me. But being a minority does not mean the same thing as being discriminated against. I cannot tell you about the racism in general, and especially systemic racism. I only have snapshots, the occasional moment when I get a glimpse into the racism that exists every day and for so many people in the US and around the world. You can see this photograph. It's from my 20th high school reunion. And I'll give you a brief description. We're having our reunion. David Duboff is in the top left. My friend Sylvia and John Landecker are in the top right. And then Sylvia and I are in the bottom. And I picked this because I wanted the picture of Sylvia and me. Because it's easy for me to say, well, I've always had a Black friend. And one of my best friends in school was a Black friend. And one of my best friends at church was a Black friend. And we socialized with a Black family. But, you know, it's all Sylvia. And it's only Sylvia. And so Sylvia was all of those things to me, but it didn't teach me anything about systemic racism. Sylvia's family were from Tulsa, and they were involved, they were part of the Black Wall Street riots in Tulsa. And after that, five of them moved to Ann Arbor and all got graduate degrees. And Sylvia has an uncle who was a professor at Oberlin. Her father had a very successful business. Her mother and her uncle and her aunt were all teachers. And she came from a family that was easy for me to identify with. If I base my view of systemic racism on Sylvia and her family, I would be delusional. I don't know if her brother was ever pulled over by the police. I don't know if her father was ever harassed. Actually, Sylvia and I have communicated this morning, and now I know that at least one time he was. I would never have been told if this hadn't happened, except Sylvia and I decided to have a conversation. My eyes opened when I was at Michigan State University. And I was exposed to racism. One of my eyes were open. There was a picture in the student newspaper. It was a picture of the homecoming court. And there was a lineup of the kind of people, and I'm being a little prejudicial here, or a lot, you'd expect to see in a homecoming court. Tall, athletic-looking men, beautiful blonde women, and in the middle, in front, no one standing next to her, was a Black woman who was the homecoming queen. And the lineup of people behind her were smirking or just, you could see the attitude in their eyes. And I kept that photograph for years because it was a snapshot of something I didn't expect. I felt like I had moved to Dixie. I was deep in the heart of Dixie instead of in East Lansing, Michigan. And it was very disturbing. My eyes opened again when our son was two. Lou and I had bought a house. We didn't really care about the neighbors. We bought the house because it was on a river and it had a dock and we had a canoe and we enjoyed the setting. But then Philip was 2 years old and he started to socialize with the neighbors. And one of his good friends, Matthew, had a father who called Matthew Kunta. And this was back when the program Roots was on. And Matthew had done something his father thought was stupid. And so he called his son Kunta. Well, suddenly we did care what our neighbors thought. We sold our house. We moved into the city. We moved into the most diverse neighborhood imaginable. It was a neighborhood where not only wasn't Philip a majority, no one was a majority. It was an extraordinarily wonderful, diverse neighborhood. And no one was ever going to use Kunta as an insult. We did this because we recognized that we didn't have the skills that we needed to raise our son to live in a complexly diverse world. We needed help. We needed a community to do this. And Philip was always a good student, but the other good student in his class was Keisha. And Keisha was a Black Muslim, and the two of them were always in competition to see who was the better student. And not only learned that Muslim could kick his butt, he learned that a girl could. And that was a very good experience for him. It's a life experience that I think every young man should have. After Philip moved away, and we had been in Asia for 7 years, we came back to the US and we bought a house, and we had forgotten everything we cared about when we bought our first house. We bought a house in a neighborhood that had trees and flowers, and it was very settled. And then we learned that we also had bought a house in a neighborhood where Blacks and Hispanics were supposed to be gone by the end of the day, before sunset. And we lasted there for 2 years, and then we moved here. Once again, we are in the minority. And once again, we do not suffer any negative consequences. Our white privilege came with us. Aren't we special? No, I cannot tell you about systemic racism, but I can tell you what it's like to have white privilege. Thank you.
Okay, my name is Sandy Boyd. I grew up in South Texas where there was much racist talk around me. And when I was about I don't think I ever thought of myself as a racist. I saw racism around me. And I never thought of myself as being racist. I remember when I was about 12 and I had become a woman. I was at in Houston visiting my cousin, and it was evening. And she said, okay, you kids go get in the car. We're going to take Jessie Mae home. And so we did, and got in the back seat as kids do. And in a few minutes, Jessie Mae came out and opened the door, looked in and said to me, don't you want to get in the front seat? And that seems strange to me, but adults did strange things all the time. So I said, I'm already back here. You sit up there. And she stood outside. And a few minutes later, she said to me again, why don't you get in the front seat? And it still seemed strange to me. And so I declined. Then my cousin came out and said to me, why don't you get in the front seat and let Jessie Mae get in the back? She'll be more comfortable back there. Well, now I got it. I'm trying to be persuaded to be the Southern white lady. And I declined. And Jessie Mae got in the front seat. We took her home. And she invited us into her house for a drink of water, which was unprecedented. And I'm glad this happened because it put a lie to all of the stuff I had been told about Black people being lazy and dirty and everything. Her house was the cleanest house I've ever seen in my life. And she had a row around the, close to the ceiling, of canned goods. We're talking all the way around the room. And I know the amount of work it takes to can tomatoes and everything else. So this is not a lazy person. And that definitely shifted all of the stereotypes I had heard into the big lie category. And yet I was trained to be a white person. And that conditioning doesn't go away. But I was not aware of the conditioning till I was in Houston years later. And I had graduated and had my PhD and had studied feminism and gone through feminist consciousness raising and learned, fortunately, that we are complicit in the sexism that we experience. That was an important, enlightening sort of realization. And that set me up so that when I went to Dialogue Racism, and this was interesting because I knew about Dialogue Racism from the Houston Peace and Justice newsletter and everything, but I had never stepped out of my comfort zone to go there until one summer my friend and I usually have dinner to celebrate our birthdays that are one day after the other. And I called her to say, let's go to, where are we going to go to dinner? And she said, we're going to Dialogue Racism. So I said, so will I. That turned out to be the best birthday present I've ever given myself, because it was a life-changing experience. Racism is so much more than I ever had a clue about. And we learned about environmental racism and institutional racism and cultural racism and internalized racism and unaware racism. Now, unaware racism took me a while to get it. And I finally, after the second time going through Dialogue Racism, I really began to understand what this is all about. And so I began doing presentations at the National Conference on Race and Ethnicity in higher education. And I did that for, a number of years. And Cherry Steinwinder from the Center for Healing Racism joined me the last 4 or 5 years that I went. And then the White Privilege Conference came along and we shifted and started going to the White Privilege Conference. White privilege is the issue. And understanding that and changing that is the work we have to do. And so for all of these 30 years since then, I have been supporting the Center for Healing Racism, working on my racial conditioning. I still consider myself a racist in recovery, a racially conditioned person in recovery. Nowadays, I'm reading Ibram X. Kendi, and we had a UU discussion. I've had a discussion at my college about Kendi. The Jung Center has had a discussion on Kendi. And so we're learning what he has to say about how to be an anti-racist. And there's a long list. And so I think about, what am I actually doing to change the system? And perhaps the conference we had last year and the one we will have this year, I hope, are part of that effort. This happened in April 2018. The poet Theo E.J. Wilson came to Unity Church to read his poetry and talk about his experience as a Black man in Los Angeles. And it was extremely moving and extremely effective. And the Q&A went on and on. It was like old home week. There were people I had met in dialogue racism, facilitators of anti-racist workshops in other places. And so over the years, I didn't realize how many people I have met who are doing this work. So it was like old home week. Well, finally there was a lull in the Q&A, and Theo said, you know, we come together in situations like this, and we're around like-minded people who are working for change, and we're hopeful, and it's a wonderful feeling, this hope. Then we go home, and institutionalized racism is still there. When are we going to do something about that, he asked. That hit me like a brick. Mentally, I'm screaming, now. If not now, when? If not us, who? If not here, where? Okay, so I've got this commitment to do something. And then the question is, what? How are you going to attack this issue? And a number of us at the Center for Healing Racism had suggested having a conference before to try to get at what to do. And so this idea came up again. So when Waking News happened, Waking News is where people gather at the Center for Healing Racism and read articles that we've encountered in the newspaper or wherever that are about racism, and we talk about that. So at the next Waking News, when it was over, I took a sheet of paper and I said to everybody, we want to have a conference to talk about institutional racism. Who would like to help? And I got a list of a couple dozen people. And somebody said, what are you going to call it? And so we just stopped right there and brainstormed and decided to call it A Way Forward, Healing Racism, a conference on dismantling institutionalized racism. And so it was begun. And last October, we had a conference for 2 days. And we had different speakers talking about all the different forms of racism. And we had room for about 100 or so people and videotaped it. And hopefully at some point in the near future, those videotapes are going to be online at the Center for Healing Racism website. And so that was my last major effort. What I do on a short-term basis from time to time is support organizations. This is one of Kendi's suggestions in his TED talk. Do something to support organizations that are working to end racism, working to dismantle the structures that make it possible for institutionalized racism to occur and damage so many people and benefit the rest of us. And so ACLU, Black Lives Matter, Americans for Separation of Church and State, there are organizations that are trying to get people released from prison who were unjustly incarcerated. There are organizations working on trafficking, which is modern slavery that still goes on. And so these various organizations I throw money at. And of course, the Unitarian Universalist Organization and the Center for Healing Racism. So I'm able to do those kinds of things. And hopefully the conference is helping to raise awareness that we need to dismantle the structures. And I'm happy to be still able to talk about these kind of things. And I very much appreciate your having me. It's been quite an experience, and I thank you all for that.
Good morning. I grew up white and middle class in Dallas, Texas, where I was born and lived until I graduated from high school. If you did not grow up in the South, some of what I'm going to talk about may sound strange. For me, the current attempts to remove Confederate symbols, flags, and statues, the reasons given for defending them at the march and counter-protest in Charlottesville dredged up 50-year-old memories. Little background. I grew up on the edge of a black neighborhood, literally across a two-lane intersection. My parents never used the N-word where I heard it, but racism was pervasive in the culture. I didn't even recognize it as a child. No one talked directly about other races being inferior. I do remember separate water fountains and jokes that still make me wince. But that was just the way it was. The state fair held in Dallas was only fully integrated in the late 60s. In Texas, when I grew up, you could talk to older people who would refer to the Civil War as the War of Northern Aggression. That was the way history was taught in public school. I'm a great believer in the effects of early education on long-term attitudes. We learned that Lincoln took office, threatened states' rights, which rights were never mentioned. South Carolina declared independence, and the rest of the South, including Texas, followed. School never discovered slavery much beyond the fact that it had existed. The only mention of John Brown, later in my adult life, was that he sees the armory of Missouri was put down by U.S. troops led by Robert Lee, and that Lee and other Confederate generals led the South in the noble cause noble lost cause against overwhelming odds. Frederick Douglass, Harriet Tubman, and Nat Turner were never mentioned. After the war, Northern scallywags and blacks disenfranchised white Southerners for personal gain. No mentions of lynching, the KKK, or Jim Crow. It was an intentional omission of key issues and facts. My elementary school, all 180 of us, was about 75% black. At school, I played with black kids. We shared the lunchroom, the playground, but my classroom was almost all white. Outside Boy Scouts, we never socialized. In middle school, almost none of these black students were still with me. This was the time I first really realized something was wrong. Some of these kids were still in my Boy Scout troop, but their middle school and high school had rezoned them to all black segregated schools. In 1971, I began to attend Dallas Thomas Jefferson Junior High School with around 1,800 students in a three-year program. At the introductory orientation for incoming sophomores, we stood as a group and pledged allegiance to the flag. And then the 30 by 50 Confederate battle flag dropped at the back of the auditorium stage, and we all sang Dixie. All but about 35 black students who did not stand. This was the standard for all of our school events. In 1971, Dallas was still resisting integration. Local schools were integrated based on area, but Dallas was racially divided by Interstate 30. South of it was mostly black. North was mostly white. In 1972, forced integration of public schools was ordered by a federal judge. I went and pulled up my 1971 high school yearbook. Senior class photos showed 580 graduating seniors, six of them black. In my junior year, around 600 black students were bused into Thomas Jefferson, about a third of the student body. And students from Thomas Jefferson were bused to black high schools. I wasn't one of them. Some of these were the same kids from my elementary school who I hadn't seen in 3 years. It was a culture class, one of the solidly middle-class, almost all-white schools was integrating with one of the poorest black neighborhoods from far across town. Immediately, controversy erupted. White parents and students who were bused complained about their children receiving substandard education at the new school. Black students objected to the use of the Confederate battle flag, gray uniforms, and Dixie. And no one liked being bused, let's be honest. This is why the marches at Charlotte, the removal of Confederate symbols 50 years after my high school, look so familiar. We had walkouts, both black and white. We had fights. Black students demanded change of the school mascot. White students and their parents protested against any change. Both sides threatened lawsuits. We still sang Dixie at school functions, but instead of 35 students sitting silent, a third of the class was sitting. I was clueless. I still drove a friend's pickup truck to football games that year with 4 3-foot by 5-foot Confederate battle flags flying from the back of the truck. What the heck, Bobby Lee and Stonewall Jackson were heroes whose biography I read in middle school. Looking back, no one talked about Sherman or Grant, except for Sherman's march to the sea. I had friends who, as teenagers, were Confederate reenactors. We didn't consider ourselves as racist. Our privileges and opportunities were to us like a fish in water. Having never been taught about the horrors of racism and slavery, I didn't really see or understand the effects of these symbols. Dallas didn't have the riots in the 60s that broke out in other American cities. Having no black friends closer than that of an acquaintance, I had no one who would explain it to me. Our principal, along with the school board, overruled the protesters. Thomas Jefferson was going to change. and UMass God was chosen, the Patriots. Instead of the Confederate battle flag, the 13-star Betsy Ross flag became the school emblem, and a symbolic middle man was chosen is chosen for the school image. The result was my 1973 school built had no Confederate symbolism, no strikes, and no walkouts. Yearbook that year showed 618 seniors, 47 of them black, and 148 unpictured seniors. I suspect that many of my black classmates were not pictured because senior pictures cost about $5 then, which was around 3 hours at the minimum wage. Many a time can be schools of systemic racism as well as education. The girls' high school trail team was featured in the local paper because despite integration, it was still mostly white. Primary reason listed in the paper, multiple uniforms that cost $650, about $3,800 today. My senior prom tickets were originally going to be $75, which would have included a nationally known band you could hear on the radio. This would have excluded many students. Many other school activities didn't integrate well because they required money and time before or after school. If you missed the school bus, Dallas's primitive bus system wasn't going to get you home fast. I am left to wonder what our current civil discourse would be like today if those active school activities we participated in would have been available to everyone without extra cost or time. If my now adult peers and I were taught some unmentioned facts as children. For example, the Texas Declaration of Secession from the Union was not about states' rights. It mentions slavery 18 times as the primary cause. If we had studied what men and women like John Brown, Sojourner Truth, Harriet Tubman, and Frederick Douglass did and said and wrote. I have hope. Change does happen. The statue of Robert E. Lee in Lee Park that my classmates posed on was removed by a 13-1 vote of the city council and sold to a private golf course in South Texas in 2017. The park was renamed Turtle Creek Park. In 2018, Dallas changed the names of all four schools named for Confederate generals. Starting in 2019, middle school children in Texas are being taught that slavery was the primary cause of the Civil War. I continue to think you can teach understanding and love and not hate. Thank you.
Today is a song that was written in 1963 by the wonderful jazz pianist and composer Billy Taylor. And the song became a civil rights anthem in the 60s, particularly after Nina Simone made a recording of this. For my British colleagues who watch TV on a Friday night in the 80s and 90s, we'll also recognize this as a theme tune to a film review program, and that program lasted for probably about 20 years. And I love this theme, and I never knew what it was when I watched the program, and then I found out, and now it's my pleasure to play it for you. I wish I knew how it would feel to be free.
Our closing words are by Max A. Kutz. After the words, a quiet. After the songs, a silence. After the crowd, only the memory recalls the gathering. Peace and justice have need of you after the words, the music, and the gathering. God grant you the depth for dedication to justice. God grant you the will to be an apostle of peace. Amen. Now let us extinguish our chalices with these words, which we read together. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we keep in our hearts and share with all the world. Please stay around if you like for discussion. We will start with small groups of about 8, and you can turn on your cameras and unmute yourselves. We have some discussion questions for you. Enjoy your discussion.